China taking shots at the Philippines on Christmas Day. The Asian powerhouse again accusing Manila of repeatedly infringing on its territory in the South China Sea, spreading false information and colluding with extraterritorial forces to cause trouble. China's Communist Party mouthpiece, the People's Daily, wrote in a commentary Monday, "The Philippines has relied on U.S. support to continually provoke China with such extremely dangerous behavior, seriously harming regional peace and stability." Tensions between Beijing and Manila have heightened in recent months as both sides trade accusations over a spate of run-ins in disputed waters, including charges that China rammed a ship this month carrying the Philippine Armed Forces Chief of Staff. In the wake of rising tensions, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has called for a paradigm shift in Manila's approach in its maritime row with Beijing. This, as he claims, Philippine diplomatic efforts with China are heading in a poor direction. The world has barely recovered from the devastation caused by the COVID-19 pandemic when two major conflicts erupted, posing a major threat to global stability. This report takes a look at the Israel-Hamas war and Russia's invasion of Ukraine.
The year 2023 was defined by two major global conflicts: Russia's invasion of Ukraine and the war between Israel and the Palestinian group Hamas. On October 7, terror group Hamas launched a massive surprise attack on Israel, infiltrating the country through air, land, and sea. Over 1,200 people were killed in the incursion as Israel was caught by surprise. Most of the victims were Israeli citizens, but other foreign nationals, including Filipinos, were not spared. 240 people, including children and the elderly, were also taken and brought back to Gaza by Hamas. Israel's response was swift and devastating. For Israel's leaders, wiping Hamas off the face of the earth was the end goal.
I've ordered an extensive mobilization of reserves and that we return fire of a magnitude that the enemy has not known. The enemy will pay an unprecedented price. In the meantime, I call on the citizens of Israel to strictly adhere to the directives of the army and home front command. We are at war and we will win it.
Israel tightened the noose on Gaza, cutting off the entry of food, water, fuel, and electricity. Various infrastructures allegedly used by Hamas to launch attacks in Israel were reduced to rubble as bombs rained down on the enclave. Hamas retaliated with rocket attacks of their own. U.S. President Joe Biden visited the Middle East on October 18 to show support for Israel. As foreign mediators worked for the release of hostages, Israel rolled out a ground offensive and expanded operations inside Gaza.
I'm deeply concerned about the clear violations of international humanitarian law that we are witnessing in Gaza. Let me be clear, no party to an armed conflict is above international humanitarian law.
Amid mounting calls for a humanitarian pause in the fighting, a limited number of foreign nationals were allowed to evacuate through the Rafah border crossing into Egypt on November 1st. An estimated 7,000 foreign passport holders, dual nationals, and people needing urgent medical aid were permitted to cross. Weeks later, Qatar successfully mediated a deal for a ceasefire. The cessation in hostilities allowed the entry of much-needed humanitarian aid. It also allowed hostages to be released, including two Filipino captives. However, the truce was short-lived. Upon the end of the truce and the return of conflict, the international community scrambled to find a resolution. On December 12, the United Nations General Assembly voted to demand an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. 153 nations voted in favor of it, while 10 voted against and 23 abstained.
I used my recent attendance at the Doha Forum and every other platform I can to encourage cooperation among states with the same singular goal in mind: to make peace for all. In the name of humanity, I ask you all once again, stop this violence now. I thank you.
But this declaration did little to silence the guns of war. Another conflict that caused major global disruption is Russia's attack on Ukraine. In February 2022, Russian President Vladimir Putin claimed Ukraine needed to be demilitarized and denazified. The invasion is largely seen as Moscow's attempt to regain territory it lost after the collapse of the Soviet Union. The war between the two countries continues to be felt across the world. Importations in African and Middle Eastern countries took a major hit. Prices of staples such as wheat, grain, and cooking oil soared in several nations due to the conflict. The conflict also drove up the cost of oil and fuel prices. There was a steep spike in prices worldwide after countries banned Russian oil, gas, and diesel. The war also triggered a major refugee crisis. Over 9 million Ukrainians were forced to flee the country. This put a strain on neighboring European countries like Poland and Germany. As of October 2023, a UN office estimated nearly 10,000 civilian casualties in Ukraine during Russia's invasion. But it admits the real numbers could be considerably higher. Meanwhile, a U.S. intelligence report in December says the war has cost Russia around 315,000 dead and injured troops. The international community largely threw its support behind Ukraine. Several countries imposed tight import and trade sanctions on Russia in retaliation of its invasion. Nations such as the United States, Denmark, Great Britain, and other European Union institutions also pledged military aid to Ukraine. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky believes Ukraine will soon overcome Russian forces to finally achieve peace.
We stand firm. No matter what Putin tries, he hasn't won any victories. Thanks to Ukraine's success in defense, other European nations are safe from the Russian aggression, unlike in the past. Ukraine can now tackle the Russian dictatorship, so our children and other nations won't have to shed their blood and sacrifice lives defending against Russian aggression. We've already made significant progress. We've shown that our courage and partnership are stronger than any Russian hostility.
The war in Gaza rages on Christmas Eve. Israel's army said it struck another 200 targets in the past 24 hours in the besieged Palestinian territory, where it is seeking to defeat Hamas and free remaining hostages. The focus of Israel's military operation has turned to southern Gaza, where most displaced Palestinians are trapped. Gaza officials said more than 200 people were killed in 24 hours of Israeli strikes. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu dismisses reports that the U.S. had convinced his country not to expand its military activity. The Wall Street Journal reported on Saturday that Netanyahu was persuaded by U.S. President Joe Biden not to attack the militant Hezbollah group in Lebanon. But Netanyahu asserts Israel is, quote, not dictated by external pressures.
I told President Biden that we will fight until a complete victory, however long it takes. The United States understands that. I have seen false publications claiming that the U.S. prevented and is preventing us from conducting operations in the region. This is not true. Israel is a sovereign state. Our decisions in the war are based on our operational considerations, and I will not elaborate on that.
Gaza's healthcare system now being decimated. That's according to the World Health Organization, citing Israel's incessant attacks on Gaza's hospitals, which it says should have been protected under international law. Of Gaza's original 36 hospitals, only 9 are now partially functional, and all of them overwhelmed with war victims. This as the Strip's entire population is also facing outbreaks of diseases caused by shortages in food, clean water, and medicines. The World Health Body now reiterating its call for a ceasefire in the nearly three-month-long war. A bittersweet Christmas for the family of Paul Castelvi, or Castelvi, the Filipino killed during an attack by Hamas in southern Israel. After 3 agonizing months, the Castelvi family was finally able to bring home his ashes to Pampanga. Paul's wife, Jovel, who's also an overseas Filipino worker in Israel, carried his ashes back home over the weekend. She also carried their one-month-old baby in her arms. On December 26, Paul's ashes will be taken to his wife's hometown of Cabanatuan City in Nueva Ecija, where the burial is scheduled for December 30th. Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky assures his country of an eventual victory over Russia, the Ukrainian leader said that in his Christmas message released on Sunday. He also said he is praying for the end of the war, which began in February 2022. This will be the first time Ukraine will celebrate Christmas Day on December 25. That's after Zelensky signed into law a parliamentary bill to abandon the Russian cultural and religious heritage of celebrating the holiday on January 7, in a move aimed at distancing the country from Russian traditions.
Step by step, day by day, darkness is losing, and darkness will finally lose. The evil will lose. It is our common goal, our common dream, and our common prayer for our freedom, for our victory, for our Ukraine, for the day when we will be able to gather all together at home in a peaceful year, during a peaceful Christmas, and we'll tell each other the Christ was born.
Over at the Vatican, those suffering from wars remembered by Pope Francis during his Angelus prayer on Christmas Eve. The pontiff urged the faithful to think of Palestine, Israel, and Ukraine. He told the faithful not to confuse celebration with consumerism. Instead, he called on them to share with those who lack necessities or companionship. Later that evening, Pope Francis spoke on the conflict in the Holy Land during his homily at the St. Peter's Basilica. He lamented that Jesus' message of peace was being drowned out by the futile logic of war in the very land where he was born. The death toll in the magnitude 6.2 quake that struck northwest China rises to 149. Two others remain missing a week after the devastating incident. On Saturday, Chinese Premier Li Qiang visited several quake-hit areas. He assured survivors the top priority is to keep them warm and safe amid the cold winter weather. He also called on relief workers to race against time to send relief supplies and to build temporary houses as fast as possible. An explosion at a Chinese-funded nickel processing plant in eastern Indonesia leaves 13 people dead and 38 others injured. The deceased were identified as 8 Indonesians and 5 Chinese workers. The blast occurred early Saturday, but the fire was extinguished only on Sunday. Initial investigations show the explosion happened during repair work on a furnace when a flammable liquid ignited and caused nearby oxygen tanks to explode as well. Britain set to deploy a naval ship to Guyana later this month amid the South American country's border dispute with Venezuela. The deployment comes following the visit of a British official earlier this month to Guyana, a UK ally and a former British colony. The move, though, not sitting well with Venezuela, which said it will remain on alert to provocations that put at risk peace and stability in the Caribbean. The territory in question, the over 160,000 square kilometer region of Essequibo, generally recognized as part of Guyana. But Venezuela revived its claim in recent years after major oil and gas discoveries. Over in Mexico, thousands of migrants spent Christmas Eve walking towards the U.S. According to the United Nations, they are heading to the U.S. in hopes of escaping violence, economic distress, and the negative impacts of climate change. The number of people crossing the perilous Darien Gap, which straddles Colombia and Central America, has topped 500,000 this year. This doubled last year's record.